Hey folks, so I'm going to be working on the diorama base for the D7 Dozer and the Tiger 2. So basically what I've done so far is not much. I glued it to a piece of plywood and that's it. I smeared some carpenter's glue on a sheet of plywood that I had cut, and then I laid the piece of foam on it, and after I scored the bottom with a bunch of lines going all different directions, it adheres better, wouldn't you? You got to score the surface of the wood too. I just do it with a razor saw, right? And so you score both surfaces, you stick them together, and you know, you clamp them down, put some weight in the middle, right? And I use your weight today. Done. So pretty simple. Anyway, I use plywood because it's crazy strong. I don't usually use just a straight piece of wood because it's not uniformly strong. Now, I do that because it's surprising how much strength is involved in the shrinking of damp material as it dries. Celluclay and modeling clay has surprised me many times at how strong it can be and how much it can cause things to curl up. So I've taken quite a few steps here and there over time to make sure things are secure. This is a long, wide, flat space, so I'm going to take an extra level of, I guess, care with this. I'm going to put some 4 drywall screws, one in each corner, on this and mount them in the foam to hold it down. It just gives it like 4 pegs to grab a hold of, so it doesn't lift at the corners, because sometimes that happens and it's kind of annoying. I've done it in the past and it's worked, so I'll do it with this one. I wasn't planning on making the surface with the celluclay too thick, so it probably wouldn't be a problem, but I'd rather hedge my bets and make sure it doesn't become a problem. So so that's not a big deal to do. It only takes a moment to do. But, whole drawer of drywall screws right here somewhere. So just, you know, the short drywall screws. These are screws that are used to mount the, well, it's called drywall here. I don't know, sheet rock or gyp rock, wall board. It's called many different things. It's just stuff that you know, you put on your wall in your room made out of gypsum. So anyway, it's just, you know, the screws just need to be flush mounted, so they don't need to, I don't want them to penetrate all the way through. I just want it to hold onto the surface, and I want the head to be slightly exposed on the foam, so it's not pulling down through. So that's what I'm going to do now. So I just need 4 of them. And then I'm going to mix up celluclay. So this is celluclay. Celluclay is the, there's 2 different kinds, well, that I use anyway. There's gray and then there's white. I tend to use the white more often than the gray. The gray is a little bit, it's supposed to be less quality, but I've never found that. It's just a different color. This is made from newsprint, and the white stuff is made from just white bleached paper. I haven't noticed a difference in the quality between the two of them, but some people say there is. But for what I use it for, I haven't noticed it. So simple tools that I need to mix celluclay. So I need celluclay, obviously, a spoon, and something to mix it in, and water. And I usually add some color to it. I'm going to be painting it at some point if it's not quite dark enough. But I usually find adding a little bit of paint to it beforehand means I have less to cover later. And you don't need to add a lot of this to it. So, but anyway, so the first thing I'm going to do is add the drywall screws. I need my screwdriver. Not a complicated process. But it is if you don't have the right bit. It's a very complicated process. Which one do I want? Not that one. And that's that. So now when it comes to mixing up Celluclay, it's really not a complicated process. Basically, I usually go with one handful at a time. This is going to probably need two handfuls. That's my unit of measurement, handfuls. I don't really know what that is, but two balls of that, about the size of my hand, should be enough to cover this. Might be a little bit extra. Don't save the extra. Damp Celluclay stored in a jar will start to smell like vomit after maybe a couple of days. So don't save Celluclay. And if you do, and you try to make a diorama of it a couple of weeks later, you're going to regret it because it takes forever for that smell to go away. So do not save excess Celluclay, throw it away. It's just paper mache, so it's completely biodegradable. So don't keep it. I've made that mistake. I have a couple of, well, I used to, I don't have many more, of stinky dioramas. They smell like vomit. So don't keep them. All right, so mixing up the Celluclay is basically you take two balls. I usually do one at a time, put them in the jar, and then I add enough water to make it look like oatmeal, like mixed oatmeal. And I mix it up, and I include the moisture value, so I add the water in the paint, and that's two of them together, because if you mix it up to make it look like oatmeal and then add the paint, you're making it even more moist, because this is also liquid. So you have to take this into account as being liquid. So add the paint and the water at the same time, and then mix it so that you get the right balance for making it look like oatmeal. I don't have a sink in this room, and I don't have a way to set up a camera in there, so I'm not going to. So I'm going to go and mix this up, and then I'll show you what it looks like when it's done, so you get an idea of what it looks like when it's done. So back in a sec. Okay, so Celluclay is mixed up. That's what it looks like there. A little bit like cement, I guess. Oatmeal-ish, right? So pretty goopy. Right. That's basically what you're looking for. It goes into the bowl like a really dusty powder. So you add the water slow because it makes a big cloud of dust if you add it too quick. And you mix it slow. Otherwise, it makes a big cloud of dust if you're too quick. You add the paint and the water. I usually add the paint first and then add the water on top of it and then mix it slowly with a spoon. You add a little bit more water and a little bit more water and a little bit more and so on and so on and so on until you get to the consistency you want. You don't dump all the water at once because once it's in, you can't get it out. So at least that's my experience. So I've been doing this a while, so I figure, chances are I might have got it right by now. Maybe. And I learned how to do this from guys who've been doing it a lot longer than me. So now that I got the Celluclay mixed up, the first thing I do is I want to coat the surface of this with a little bit of glue. It's just to increase the adhesion factor. There's glue built into the Celluclay. Some people add dish soap to the Celluclay when they're mixing in the water and stuff. It thins the meniscus, the surface tension of the water, so it mixes faster. I've never had a need to do that. It's never been something I've ever needed to do. If you want to do that, go ahead. But I see no appreciable difference when I do it, so I see it as pointless. But it's up to you. If you want to try it, go ahead. If you don't see it as pointless, well, that's good. Yay. One thing I will do is increase the adhesion factor to the surface of this, though. So I'll add white glue to it. Another level of hedging my bets, anyway. I don't need to add massive amounts of it. I just need enough to get a coat. Oops. Don't squeeze the bottle while you're doing that. Otherwise that happens. You get a barf bubble. Right. Now I tend to use paper towel for this because tissue or snot rag or Kleenex tends to disintegrate too fast. So, and then I smear the glue everywhere. I don't use a paintbrush for this because it kind of fucks up your paintbrush. So I use paper towel because they're disposable and so is the glue. Now you got about 20 minutes of work time on this surface before the glue becomes really kind of unworkable. So keep that in mind. It takes about 20 minutes. Depends on the day. If you got a really hot, dry day, it'll dry a lot faster. If it's a humid day, it dries a little bit slower. If it's a cold day, it dries a lot slower. Well, it depends on the weather. And the more you rub it, it'll dry faster. So, I don't know if you ever noticed that about white glue, PVA, when it's on your fingers. You rub it, it dries. Ah, see, I can do that and it'll dry. Now it's dry. So, yeah, it does the same thing when you're rubbing it with a paper towel, especially on foam. Foam creates a lot of heat. All right. So, simple tools. I usually have an artist spatula, very handy tool. Small spoon, medium sized spoon, big grandma whack you in the face spoon. My grandmother actually had one of these spoons and she used to whack me with it. I guess it explains a lot, eh? So, I basically start in the center and work my way out. Now, one of the things you got to try and remember when you're working is the topography that you intended to create. So if you've pre-shaped your base, like I have with a rotary tool or carving or whatever, you gotta remember the original shape that you were going for. So now when I started working on this, I wanted a road, flat road with some depressions on either side, that, you know, like a partial ditch, right? And I had originally had the road in a certain place, but then I decided to move it because of where the telegraph pole was going to be. So I have to keep that in mind as I'm doing this, because it's a correction that I have to make, and it's something I can easily forget, and there's a good chance I might as I'm doing this too, right? So like I said, I start spreading it in the middle. And you try to keep the layer that you're spreading one layer at a time, no thicker than about maybe 5 millimeters, half a centimeter. I don't know how many inches that is. So I try to keep it thin. Anything thicker than that, and it takes a really long time to dry, and it runs the risk of cracking. It also becomes really strong when it dries, and it runs the risk, a stronger risk of lifting and bending your diorama. So the thicker it is, the stronger it is when it dries. So you'll get warping going on if it's too thick. And I've, you know, discovered that many times, but by adding it too thick. There's lots of times where I've actually done it on purpose. I wanted it thick, but I've done it in certain places where I knew it wasn't going to warp anything because it was in a shallow depression where it wouldn't get a hold of any, like in a ditch. If I'm building up a ditch or something like that, it's really hard for it to warp in that area because there's nothing for it to grab a hold of. I know that's kind of hard to understand, but like I could fill this up a bit, up to about maybe a centimeter, and it wouldn't bend it, wouldn't warp it, because it's a concave surface, so it tends not to warp there. But if it was the other way around, if it was a convex surface, so if it was shaped like this rather than like this, it would probably warp it. So it's just the way the celluclay works. So yeah, so keep it less than a centimeter deep if you can. 5 millimeters is usually where I go, so I have a centimeter. If you've got a phone, you can look up what that is in inches. I don't have a clue. Sometimes I work in inches, sometimes I don't. It depends on what the context is. There's certain things that work. This is the thing about being in Canada. Half the country does things in inches and the other, it's actually not the country. Half of what we do is done in inches and the other half is in the metric system. And it's weird the way we use it too. Europe tends to use a lot of things, they measure things in millimeters. In Canada, we measure everything in centimeters. It's like, you know, you'll get model kits that are measured in the metric system that come out of Europe. They're all measured at, like, they're 120 millimeters long. But in Canada, you would measure that, like, you know, it'd be 12 centimeters long. It's just the way things, it's stupid. I just wish they'd unified in Canada and stop using the imperial system altogether. It would just make things easier, right? Because, like, my kids have no understanding of the imperial system at all. Because they don't use it, then it's not taught in schools, there's no relationship to it at all. And they won't have any understanding of it when they go to, you know, build a patio or deck, or deck and a patio are almost the same thing, but their house or anything, because the builders that they hire are all going to be talking in inches and stuff like that. My kids won't know what the fuck they're talking about, because they aren't taught that in school. So, you know, they'll be relying on handy converting apps on their phones, I guess, because they're just not taught it in school. They don't even teach them to convert them, at least not as far as I know. Not around here, anyway. They don't even talk about the imperial system, really. It's just one of those weird things. Half-breed metric or half-breed math system. All right. So I'm just generally trying to maintain a somewhat smooth surface. Now the texture of the Celluclay is meant to mimic, like, it's basically smooth earth, and that's basically what that is. So it was meant to emulate what. If you stripped off the grass, but didn't disturb the soil, that's what that's supposed to look like. And so the idea, once it's dry, is you add grass to it. So it looks like earth with grass growing out of it. That's kind of where you're going. That's the hope, anyway. That's why I use the Celluclay, because it has this really wonderful texture. Now, I'm not completely happy with it all the time, just leaving it that way. It depends on the surface. Excuse me, that was really disgusting. I didn't even know that was going to happen. I guess that's a blooper. The surface texture is great and everything, but there's, like, I don't know, I always find there's something lacking because of its uniformity. So I tend to add a little bit of extra oomph to it using pulverized bark mulch, which you're going to see me use here in a minute once I get this done. Pulverized bark mulch is, if you've ever seen what bark mulch is, it's something that people use in their gardens a lot. It's wood chips, basically, and over time it tends to disintegrate and it becomes pulverized. You can pulverize it yourself in a mortar and a pestle if you want, but I tend to just go out and get it out of my garden because nature's already done it for me. I take that and I basically collect it in a container and I bring it in the house and I stick it in a sealed container, actually, this sealed container, for a few weeks to a month. And I have several of those containers full of bark mulch and other vegetative matter. And I just leave it. Right, and basically all the organisms die off, the bugs and everything, they all die off in it and stuff like that. Some people put it in a microwave, but I tried that one time and it caught fire, so I decided maybe I'm not going to do that anymore. I have a I actually have a pretty strong phobia of fire. So having things catch fire in my kitchen is not something I ever want to repeat. So having pulverized bark mulch catch fire in my kitchen is not something I'm going to ever do again. So I don't recommend putting things like that in the microwave because there's a potential they could catch on fire, which it did. Now I just leave it in the container for a couple of weeks to a month. And, you know, I collect it in amounts that I always have stuff ready on hand, so it's not like I have to wait around for it. I mean, the first time I did it, I did, but, you know. But it's always sitting around. You know, I've seen people buy it on, like, hobby stores and stuff like that. They buy it in these little itty-bitty tiny containers for, like, $20, which, I got to say, that's really stupid. You can go in the forest and collect this stuff, right? It's just, you know, find a dead tree and take the bark off it and, you know, crush it up in a mortar and a pestle. There you go. You know, it's really, you know, don't buy it, right? It's a silly thing to buy. I mean, I can understand if you live in a city and it's impossible for you to get out, which... Well, that would be terrifying for me that I wouldn't, and it's impossible for me to leave the city. I'm a bit claustrophobic, I guess. So, but living in a place I could never escape, that's prison, as far as I'm concerned. But I live in the country, so, and I would never live anywhere else but the country. So I'm biased, heavily biased. I love it when everything is always in my way. I have a very big workspace, and everything is still always in my way. When I had a very small workspace, everything was always still in my way. And I think if I worked in a gymnasium, everything would still always be in my way. Because I want everything to be within arm's reach. And when you want everything to be within arm's reach, everything is going to be in the way. So, I guess maybe it's because I'm disorganized. I like to think I'm organized. But anyway. Just go out in the forest, make a special trip, take a couple of containers with you in your backpack or in your car or whatever, go out in the forest, find a dead tree, scrape the dead bark off it, you know, a good quantity of it, and bring it home, put it in your container, and let it sit for a couple of weeks, and there you go, you got pulverized bark mulch. Now, the reason I'm recommending it, and I'll show you why in a few minutes once I get this roadway resurfaced here. And you'll see why I use it. It's a really good texture. It's got really great color. And if I'm lucky enough to cover this diorama enough that I don't need to paint it, which is kind of what I want to do, I am going to have to paint it though. The pulverized bark mulch adds beautiful color, tone, and texture to your scene. That's extremely natural. Now I'm going to be using talus that is not exactly the right color that I want. So I am going to have to paint all this to a point. Parts of it anyway. It's just, I'm going to get around it because the color is too bright for the road. We have stuff that's dark enough. Actually, I do, but it's the wrong size. It's too big. It's overscale for what I want. The talus is for the gravel for the road. It's right over there. I don't know if you can see it. Might be out of shot. I can't see the monitor from where I'm sitting. So I don't know what I just pointed at. Now, overall, I've managed to make myself a really boring and ugly, disgusting looking birthday cake. I've managed to keep this, for the most part, it's less than half a centimeter. So, oh, thank you. That's nice. It's Alexa. She's giving me a very helpful reminder. She's so helpful. You guys can hear that. She's telling me to change the banners on the Warts and All Facebook group. Because it's time. We do that every Friday. It's kind of a little feature we do. Like to feature people's work. Now I'm gonna, what I'm doing now is I'm adding small surface changes, like little hills and bumps and stuff like that, to make it a little bit more interesting. Now there's sometimes when you're working, you'll want to keep your tools moist. So having a little thing of water nearby to dip your tools in is good. But with Celluclay, that's not exactly a great idea. And the reason why is because it adds more and more moisture content to your Celluclay. And when you make your Celluclay too wet, it takes really long periods for it to dry, like huge amounts of time to dry, more than your is probably acceptable. If you make it too wet, it can increase your drying time from 2 to 3 days to 2 to 3 weeks. And when it takes that long to dry, you increase its risk of becoming moldy because it's so damp. And so you don't want that to happen. I mean, it's a somewhat natural product, so it can rot if it's too wet for too long. So you don't want to do that if you can avoid it. So it's fairly damp and it doesn't really get all that tacky while you're working on it. So there's no real need to keep your tools damp while you're working. So it's kind of unnecessary. Now I've gone and made too much. It's an enormous amount of leftover. I don't exactly have another diorama that I need to use this with. Bad timing. It'd be nice if I did. Okay, so that's pretty much the way that thing sits now. Now the road, I can still see it. I don't know if you can see it on the camera. You might be able to. It's basically right there. I can still sort of see it. But I am going to mark it out now. Now the first thing I'm going to do is decide which material I'll use. It's probably too big. Is that for road salt, actually? This is kitty litter. Now, years ago, they used to make kitty litter that was not clumping. And I used to have a huge bag of it, but I used it all up years ago. So, unfortunately, all they make now, and I've never been able to find a supply of non-clumping kitty litter. It'd be wonderful if I could, but I can't. I have never found it. Not locally. And I'm not going to order a bag of kitty litter online because it costs too much money to ship it. At least the stuff that I would want anyway. I'd have to pay a huge amount of shipping because it would have to come from God knows where. So, but anyway, so unfortunately all I have is the clumping kind. I don't like the clumping kind because it doesn't, I have to constantly unclump it, right? So, but anyway, unfortunately my kitty litter got damp one time and so it has clumps in it. But anyway, so basically, the first thing I'm going to add is the kitty litter to the road surface, because I wanted to find the road. But the kitty litter is basically going to go on the road side, so it's basically going to mark the perimeter of the road. Because, I don't know if you noticed or not, but some of the on a gravel road, the road itself tends to be somewhat smooth because that's where all the travel is. But the road side tends to be a lot more rough. Now, in the case of this road, the dozer has really messed it up. So a lot of this is going to get obliterated as I work. But I need to mark it out first. So what this is texture that I'm adding, and it'll all get glued down when they work. Some of it will get tamped down and basically pushed into the surface as I'm working.
So that was kitty litter.
The next thing I'm going to add is ballast. Now you can use this, you can use like coarse sand, either will work. I use this is because it's what I have. And this is what I'm using for the road itself. Now I'm just adding texture to it. Now the road that I'm trying to emulate is reasonably smooth because the dozer has done quite a bit of work to it. So it doesn't need an abundance of texture. Now I know you're probably thinking, well, what about the track marks and everything that appear in the picture? Well, that's going to get in there too. There's a thing I have to do after I get all this on first. Track marks are like the last thing you add because they go on top of everything. Everything that you do is under the track marks. So you have to add all this so that it's under the track marks. Add some finer stuff. I need a lot of this. This is just fill. It blends out the surface so it's not all just large and small rocks. Now, I can also add beach sand. Beach sand is quite a varied texture. There's all kinds of different size particles in it. And I got this, funny enough, at the beach. That's that. Now, before I add the round scatter, the pulverized bark mulch, I usually add gravel, small stones to the scene. Anyone who's done any garden work, it's always stones. Always a damn rock. All right, where's my... usually tamp these in a bit because they don't tend to sit on the surface. They tend to be in the surface. They also stick better. Road. Right. Now I'm going to add this is the pulverized bark mulch. That's what it looks like. It's literally powder mixed with large and small particles of crap mixed in there, and that's basically it. Now, I don't pulverize it with a mortar and pestle or anything, because nature's already done it. But if you don't have the time to wait for it, you can do that yourself, if that is how you want to roll. Now, I need some glue. I'll be right back. Okay, so I get the glue. It's basically a Mod Podge that's thinned with water, and I put it in a hairspray bottle thing. So anyway, you got to clean these things out before you use them, otherwise they won't work. So anyway, I spray the glue on, and spray the road too. Now the bark mulch will absorb most of the moisture, so you don't have to worry about it unless you are really slow putting it on. The bark mulch will absorb most of the moisture of the glue. Alright, so I've done this. The road is pretty much going to look like it did the day that the tiger was probably knocked out. And my plan is to add once this is dry, some more Celluclay to beef that. Actually, that's not true. I don't think I'm going to do that. So I'm kind of planning this out in my head as I'm going. And my original plan seems to have gone awry. See, that happens. Remember how at the beginning of the video I said you got to keep your plan in your head as you're working, because as you're going, sometimes it tends to change. Well, that's what's happened here. Now I'm going to unchange it because I don't want it to do that. All right. So, now the way this thing looks now, because you're about to see me fix this because this is all fucked up now. So the way this was originally supposed to be, the tiger goes here, the dozer goes here, GPR, people, and telephone pole here. So this area here is supposed to be pushed up, because this is where the dozer cleared a spot for the tiger to go, and this area here is all pushed and resurfaced by the dozer, and this area here is all kicked up too, but this area, and this area is not. So I didn't do any of that. I just was talking and just built a nice lovely road. This isn't going to work. So what I'm going to do is, I'm hoping what I'm about to do with my handy dandy spatula is recreate the scene that I originally wanted. So now, trying to figure this out as I'm going, I'm making this up as I'm going along. So this is where the tiger is going. Now this is, I think he made this just incredibly smooth with the blade. Need a wet tool. Oh, I need water. Okay. I got a bucket, but I didn't get the water to go in the bucket. That's not going to work. All right. Now, let's see if I can unscrew this mess. Smooth this out. Make it look like a sharp blade has moved across it. And flat. Ah, that's working. Okay. That's exactly what I want. It's a good thing I have so much clay left over. Eh? Because I can fill these holes with it. I don't want to fill this area up too much because this is supposed to be a recessed area where the tiger is sitting. So I just want to cover it up enough that I can't see the pink foam underneath. Funny thing is, this kind of thing happens to me every time I do a diorama. I'll be like, oh wait, that's not what I wanted to do. Oh, Christ's sake. Then I have to go and undo all the clever shit that I thought I was doing. And then do less clever shit. That didn't work out. I do this all the time. That's why my dioramas kind of look like half-baked crap. Because I'm constantly having to undo the stupid shit that I do. Now the road surface on this is going to get a coat of paint, so the most of the pink foam will end up getting covered up, but I don't want large swaths of the pink foam showing. A little tiny bit is okay because it looks like it's just scraped smooth, and there's a lot of smooth texture showing up in the photograph, so you know, a lot of it I can get away with. I don't want that. It's too much. Now I purposely added texture to the foam because I had a feeling this was going to happen. Not that I was going to fuck it up this bad, but that wasn't part of the plan. But I had a feeling that during my smoothing, pink foam was going to be showing up here and there. And so that's why I added texture to it. So that when I painted it, you couldn't tell the difference between it and the rest of the celluclay. At least that was my idea. Want to make it look like blade marks. That'll probably do it. All right. Might have unscrewed it now. I need to put you on pause. I had to cut some plastic because I need to lay it over the diorama. Grab the tractor. And put track marks in. Damn it. Keep popping that stupid. There's a little window that's on the back of the tractor. I keep forgetting it's there and putting my thumb on it and then pushing down on it. And pops the stupid thing off. All right, so that's the track mark tractor. Track marks for the tiger. I can take this off carefully. Now when I paint that, my hope is that track marks are nice and visible. Explain this in just a second. That mound that I just made is a pile of shit that was pushed up by the dozer blade as it was rolling up the tiger's tracks. The tiger's tracks are going to sit right here. I can't put them there because they're going to cover in wet celluclay. They're going to sit right here. Basically, they were run out like in a long strip, and then the dozer pushed like this and causing them to roll up as it were going, and when it did, it pushed up some material as it was going, so that's what this is representing. I hope, anyway. that is that for now. If you've been paying attention, you've probably noticed that it took almost no time to put this together, because it doesn't. Just gonna give this thing a spray of glue. There we go. That's what I want. These things get clogged all the time. Even the expensive ones that you buy for doing this, they just get constantly clogged. No way to get away from it. Right, so that's going to take anywhere from 3 to 5 days to dry. And then once it's dry, I can do the next level of work, which is first I will paint this road surface here. It'll be like a kind of actually the same color as the dirt that's on the dozer, if you look at the pictures. And the this here will probably remain the same. It depends on what it looks like when it's this dry. I might darken it, I might lighten it, depends. I might just add more bark mulch to it. Over top of this bark mulch will get grass and stuff. So now, in all honesty, normally I don't add the bark mulch for like a field. Normally I just leave the celluclay, but I wanted to demonstrate the bark mulch being added. Normally I reserve bark mulch for like more foresty type settings, or like more lush type, like a hedgerow or a forest clearing or forest edge, that kind of thing. So I wouldn't normally do this, but I wanted to demonstrate it anyway as a kind of a nice effect. It's got really cool color, and so, but anyway, and I also love using bark mulch. So, but anyway, yeah, so if I had just left it with the celluclay, it means I could have painted the entire scene without any interference, and I wouldn't have to worry about overspray on the bark mulch and stuff like that. And the bark mulch does, when you're spraying, it tends to fly all over the place sometimes if it's not glued down well. So now before I spray, now normally I would pick the diorama up and flip it upside down and give it a shake, and anything loose will fly off. So I don't have to worry about it as much, but stuff still will, because an airbrush is quite a bit of pressure. So anyway, so that's the first stage here. Like I said, it's going to take about 3 to 5 days. I'm going to be really busy for the next 3 to 5 days doing stuff. And my internet is going to be pretty shit, so I won't be able to upload anything until at least Saturday, so a week from tomorrow, I guess. So hopefully I'll have something interesting uploaded after that. So, now, before I go, I wanted to say thank you for the fellows that have signed up for supporting my Patreon. I didn't think anybody would. A couple of guys have. I even have someone interested in the one-on-one session, which I didn't think anybody would. But so I just want to say thank you to you guys for doing that. I'm surprised anybody took advantage of it. So yeah, that will, in the long run, I guess, make a difference. Now, I wasn't going to do this, and it probably won't do any. I did it before, a long time ago. I had my YouTube channel monetized, but then YouTube made a bunch of stupid changes and stuff, and it made it kind of somewhat pointless. But I've re-enabled the monetization on my YouTube channel to, you know, offset costs and stuff like that. I mean, I don't like asking folks for money, so that will be a way I can maybe generate some kind of a cost offsetting thing to enable me to keep doing this kind of thing, because I want to keep doing it. I would suggest getting Adblocker, because Adblocker stops YouTube ads, but you know, that's kicking me in my own face. I don't see YouTube ads because I use it. Don't tell anybody. I'm not actually supposed to say that, believe it or not. It's in the YouTube terms and conditions. I think if it's not, it might be now. So I wanted to say thank you to the fellows that signed up on Patreon. You guys are going to make a difference. You know, as my dad always says, every contribution is always appreciated. But he's talking about things that he found at work and fell in his briefcase. So I actually mean it. He's being facetious. So, but anyway, I appreciate it. So hopefully I'll have interesting things to put on the Patreon and make it worth everybody's while. And, you know, we'll see. Anyway, that's all I got. You guys be good. Keep your stick on the ice. Bye for now. Mm-hmm.